It's time for us to be able to understand what they are asking or suggesting. So that is a second point that I would raise here. The third, I think there's still a lack of common, there's not enough maybe common studies that are comprehensive enough, that are, let's say, presented to the world. I think there is a series of studies, of course, but there are all, most of them are on specific cases or biased by different visions, etc. The point that we need to convince discussions at the international level sometimes is not shown, it's not something that we come back to the point that, well, indigenous people's spirit, and without discussing the services that their lands and their management is offering to us. So that would, let's say, open a better avenue for collaboration, for recognition that would maybe make more possible this collaboration. So, of course, this is not completely comprehensive, and it's not to just consider what was said by the others, it's just to highlight some, so I would point out those three.
Standard or in country where the standard might exist or might be a wrong or bad implementation of those standards. Thank you.
Me permitiría también tocar unos tres elementos que pudieran contribuir con el debate. Yo ya en mi presentación inicial había hecho mención a uno, y ahora me permitiría formular de manera de una interrogante. Los aliados de la conservación, los pueblos indígenas, ¿están de acuerdo que los pueblos indígenas se consoliden y lleguen a una efectiva gobernanza dentro de sus propios territorios? Yo creo que este es un punto de debate. Efectivamente, cuando se ha dicho de que los pueblos indígenas requieren que sus propias capacidades se consoliden, naturales y su territorio, sobre todo cuando están superpuestas por áreas protegidas, la respuesta que se ha tenido es que, bueno, es una cuestión solamente de gobernanza. Sentémonos a la mesa y veamos cuáles son las aristas que están sueltas y trabajemos en esta. Y llegamos a un punto en común. Entonces, yo creo que es fundamental y por lo menos en esa dirección los pueblos indígenas están caminando en función de que efectivamente sus propias gobernanzas con derecho a la libre determinación se ejercen en su propio territorio. Eso por un lado. El otro es el tema del uso y manejo de los recursos naturales. Un poco se habla cuando se habla de temas de conservación, se toca la partida. Y desde los pueblos indígenas mismos nos hemos preguntado, o sea, nunca hemos sido conservacionistas que ahora se ha acuñado este adjetivo. Los pueblos indígenas han sido milenariamente, en base a sus propias prácticas tradicionales, pues han mantenido una relación armónica. Factores externos obviamente han generado también de que se alteren determinadas prácticas tradicionales de los pueblos indígenas y no se tenga una relación muchas veces armónica con los recursos naturales y el territorio. Pero en este punto me parece fundamental cómo los pueblos indígenas pueden tener el control y manejo de los recursos. Creo que ahí sí es un punto determinante, donde sobre todo los intereses del Estado están muy presentes. Lo otro elemento que me parece importante y que no se lo toca mucho cuando se habla del tema de conservación es cómo los pueblos indígenas pueden o no caminar en el mundo de la innovación. Los territorios indígenas son muy ricos en biodiversidad. Aquí se ha dicho una y muchas veces. Y la biodiversidad está virginia en sus territorios, y ahí están los conocimientos tradicionales. Entonces, ¿qué paso dar? Obviamente hay iniciativas que yo personalmente conozco en América Latina, particularmente en mi país, que esfuerzos por prestar proyectos y programas de emprendimiento hacia las innovaciones que los pueblos indígenas puedan generar en función del uso adecuado de los recursos naturales, especial de la biodiversidad, asociado con los conocimientos tradicionales. Que esto pudiera generar, pues, obviamente, un capital natural que pueda contribuir de sobremanera con solventar las necesidades que tienen las comunidades. Estos tres elementos me parecen importantes también tener presente en que estudiar con tu vida.
Thank you very much, and I must say that I have written down many of these challenges that you have brought up. And I think one of them that will probably generate a little further discussion amongst yourselves, but we can pick it up at the second question that we discuss now, is the one of how conservation organizations deal. Is this the one of the things that you have just raised, the oceans environment that referred to indirectly? How conservation organizations perceive the rights of conservation? How can they relate to it? Because conservation organizations are not states. So how can conservation organizations work with that right? I think this is crucial. And if I can take off my hat for a moment and share and say that we found out that the United Nations that one of the biggest challenges for the human development organizations was to deal with the concept of self-determination, which is the concept of it, and to respect the self-governance structures that actually enhance them of individuals. So to see that, the value of that, I think this is a real challenge that is being brought up, of course, as a virtue for but looking back to the second question and trying to come back to this big challenge or the second question, and the second question is this. We all know that there are many human rights standards. There are standards on the measures of human rights, there are standards on conservation, international standards, and conservation. So what in your own opinion and from the perspective of your own organization and your own work, do you think are the most important standards from your perspective that should interject, that should intersect and interrelate in order for this relation to be more productive? And we are not going to go into a legal seminary, but because we are next or challenged by many standards, I think it is important to make a statement and to think what are the most important standards that we want to communicate to each other so that our relationship can be more productive, you know, in conservation and in the communities.
I'm going to take a two-part answer to the question. And there's an obvious answer around the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People. But more importantly than the Declaration itself, I think it's the practices and the principles that it codified over time around the importance of recognition of rights, around participation, around consent. And it's sort of like a fascinating debate layout around the safeguard policy for men, where we and others have been advocating with indigenous community partners for the required formats in the World Bank safeguard policies. And the World Bank safeguard required form of consultation. What's the understanding? And over time, the current version of the performance standards of the IFC, for example, now exists prior to the parental consent, because the recognition of international practice has changed as part of the Declaration. But along with the formal declaration, the principles that are there, there's also, and it could be legalistic, sort of a common law approach and an evolution of the understanding of what best practice is in the country. One of the best places to look for that is the last decade or more of the outcomes and outputs of the World Constitution process. If you look at the evolution of the dialogue here in this process, if you look at the thinking and the practice that is embodied by the IUCN resolutions. If you look at the debate from the last World Constitution or World Constitution, you start to see evolution in both the understanding of what best practice is and how to do it, the guidance that goes along with it, and even the evolution of the World Constitution to understanding what and who are indigenous communities, how best to the world. It's something that we struggle with my own organization, because as North American, you have a very clear conception communities based on who was there and who wasn't there at the time of so. There's a different conception of indigenous communities in Africa. And there's had to be an evolution in the thinking of my own organization about what does it mean? We understand what it means to relate to indigenous communities in the Amazon or in North America, and there's a different understanding of what that means in Africa. And our practices have to evolve over time. It's not codified per se. In fact, if you look at the UN Declaration, it doesn't define indigenous. And that in itself is different from what's codified by ILO Convention 169. So in part, you have to look at the actual convention, but more importantly, you have to look at and understand the subtleties of Mahalapi as practice, as it's articulated in a variety of places like the World Conservation Conference, and make sure you're always in check with what is the best practice. And part of the way to do that is by doing dialogue with partners and our business to continue dialogue operation.
Thanks. Yeah, Andrew raises a very important point that I'd just like to elaborate a little bit on. I think that the evolution of recognition of the critical role of indigenous people in overall conservation community has evolved very, very quickly. When you look back, I remember in 2002, when the Johannesburg Summit, I was there, and we went out to see, it took us about 20 minutes to get there, to a community crawl where there are indigenous groups that were performing, and if you wanted to talk to indigenous people, you had to go to this community crawl. By Bangkok, it was a little better because it was right next to the World Conservation Conference, but it was still outside, it was still a separate thing, okay? And over the course of the past few years, the last two conservation conferences, many of these other events, indigenous people are an integral part of these meetings. We're all sitting together and discussing these issues. So I think that the evolution, if I look back over the 40 years, 11 in this business, it's evolved tremendously in the past 10 years. I think that's really important. And I really do think that our conservation community, I always like to think of conservation as an entry point to democracy. I think there's so many examples where we've helped to democratize processes around the world. And I would never underestimate the ability of our organizations, present in a lot of these countries, to have influence on these policies. We're not a government. We're not a government agency. But depending on the country, that there is enormously. In many countries, we've been able to advance this in ways that 30 or 40 years ago, 20 years ago, we weren't even thinking of. So I think there's a real great role for strengthening ever more of this partnership between the traditional conservation indigenous issues. So I feel pretty good. Long ago, coming enormously long way in 10 years.
And I understand that here at this Congress, there is a motion on the floor this year to for the recognition of the Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples and to promote its implementation and conservation. So that would raise tremendous awareness, I think. Even the very mention of it might bring more people in to understand something in those locations. Who else is
there? Sí, en relación al marco normativo y precisamente lo más importante es un análisis político, es importante, digamos, ver los instrumentos que existen. Pero también es importante ver, digamos, estas resoluciones que emanan de la ICE. Porque son un marco normativo internacional que no nos estamos llevando a la práctica. Hacíamos un análisis sobre las recomendaciones del anterior Congreso en relación a pueblos indígenas que no han llevado a la práctica. Segundo, digamos, cómo las ONGs internacionales, digamos, como CEI, WWF, CNC, ponen en práctica, digamos, en sus directrices. Políticas, la declaración del progreso. Yo creo que eso es un reto que tenemos. Existen, digamos, ya algunas organizaciones que han avanzado, digamos, en tener estas políticas directrices, pero es importante, digamos, revisar hasta la luz de esa declaración. Tenemos una declaración que está, digamos, por el siglo, digamos, en el sistema del medio ambiente, no se falta la cosa. Precisamente la resolución, digamos, 107 sobre la vamos a empezar a cortar. Está la discusión, digamos, si todavía si son pueblos indígenas, si son comunidades. Está la discusión sobre si son comunidades locales, si son pueblos indígenas. Yo creo que este es un reto, digamos, de tener como estándar la línea. Lo otro interesante es ver, digamos, cómo este marco internacional muchas veces no se comprende, digamos, porque hay una resolución interesante que en una de los contenidos siga perdiendo su responsabilidad. Y lo analizábamos en el caucus indígena y decíamos, los pueblos indígenas no han estado en tiempo. Ha habido una presión externa, ¿sí?, que ha extraído los recursos. Entonces, ¿cómo logramos parar, digamos, eso trayendo esas políticas, digamos, de las políticas internacionales que han seguido trabajando en temas de conservación? Sabemos, digamos, que nosotros ya, digamos, estábamos acá, se dirige el PRD y el CEL mismo, tienen un papel muy importante, digamos, en la implementación de esas políticas nacionales. Si miramos, digamos, en América Latina, el sistema o las categorías de ellos son las categorías de ellos. Y el miedo que se cree interesante cuando ustedes puedan recuperar, ¿sí?, esos derechos de participación, de consulta, de distribución educativa, porque los estados muchas veces confían más en que las ustedes lo presenten a que plantean los procesos. ¿Cómo hacemos esa propuesta de base a la operativa en los países?
Unless someone gets forced to intervene,